Well, thank you, Mike, for that kind introduction. And just while Florian gets the presentation up, I'll echo Geraint's words of our very warm welcome here to Vienna. It's, I think, 25 years since I've been in the city, so it's been great to come back and see some familiar sights, but also quite a new positive vibe around the city. Thanks also to Harold and Karen for your very kind hospitality and invitation. When Harold asked me to come over, he suggested maybe talking about this idea of stadia and arenas as venues for, as catalysts for urban regeneration, and just looking at some of the examples around London that we've been lucky enough to be involved in. And at the time I accepted, I wasn't sure if Tottenham was going to be open, whether I'd be showing you CGIs, graphics, or whether I'd be able to show you photographs, but luckily Tottenham has opened. And so when I do the case study at the end, you'll see some actual photographs of the finished building. Just an introduction to Populous. We are a global design company. We specialize just in the design of sports and entertainment buildings. Geraint and I are in the London office that work in Europe and the Middle East. And we have offices in America, covering the Americas, and Brisbane that sort of looks at Asia. And the sort of work we do sort of the traditional architecture design, the sort of sports architecture design, but we also have an interior design company. We find the interiors of our buildings getting more and more sophisticated. We have an events group in Denver that focuses on master planning and events. They run the Super Bowl every year for the NFL. We have a landscape architecture group, which really kind of acknowledges the importance of the public realm in our projects. And we have an activation group that looks at sponsorship and brand activation. So a couple of quick examples to start with. One I'm sure you're familiar is Wembley Stadium. And this is probably one of the early projects we did in London with a major regeneration point of view. Of course, the original stadium, the National Stadium, the Twin Towers of Wembley, a big symbol of UK sport and football, but itself a legacy of the 1923 British Empire exhibition. So it had done pretty well as a stadium, hosting major concerts, events, and sports matches. But it was felt that it was no longer fit for purpose, and the proposal was to develop a new national stadium, and it ended up being on the same site. The Great Arch replaced the Twin Towers, and a 90,000-seat stadium that's been hosting major football, NFL, and concerts ever since. But what's interesting is to see how the stadium actually sits within a much wider area of regeneration. This is actually Wembley Arena itself, another legacy building from the Great Exhibition. But you'll see lots of space available for redevelopment. And the intention was that the stadium would be that catalyst to drive that regeneration in northwest London. And it's taken some time. We've had the economic crisis. But if you go to Wembley now, this is a visual of how Wembley is going to end up, but if you go to Wembley now, you'll find that most of this part of the master plan is now being built out. And I've been there a couple of times in the last 12 months, and it's incredible to see the scale of change and the redevelopment that's happening around that project. The first project that I worked on was the Emirates Stadium, and again, this was replacing the old Highbury Stadium for Arsenal with a brand new 60,000-seat stadium. And this was built just 500 metres from the old stadium. But again, it had a much wider remit. This was Highbury, the old stadium. This was the site of the new stadium. But we had key worker housing for nurses, sort of firemen. We had a lot of student housing that was located down here. We had sort of mixed-use development around the site. So it was a much, much bigger project than just the stadium itself. And when we first looked at the site that was proposed, it didn't look particularly appealing. This is a sort of site that London had plenty of. It had sort of industrial units, it had a waste processing factory, it was cut in, separated from the surrounding area by railway lines. So not a positive site for any developer to look at. But what we find is that with a project like a stadium, it can transform that type of site. We have new rail bridge links going across the railway line. You'll see a sort of site here that's been cleared for housing, the key worker housing in the corner, the new stadium, and land that's been subsequently redeveloped. So we find that these projects can take what look like very unattractive sites and they can make them much more vibrant. Highbury itself, the two historic stands were retained and converted into housing. The two end stands were redeveloped for new housing. The pitch, quite creatively, kept as landscape gardens. And you'll see here the stadium with all of the new housing and wider sort of development that came about as a part of that project. So the three projects that I'm going to focus on are the O2 Arena, the London Stadium, and Tottenham Stadium. The O2 Arena, the most successful venue in the world, didn't start off in that way. In fact, it started off with a very poor history and was seen as a symbol of the classic white elephant. The government decided that it wanted to host an exhibition to mark the millennium, and a site was found on the Greenwich Peninsula. I'll come back to this slide. It was an old gasworks, so again, a waste industrial site on the Greenwich Peninsula that the government decided it would build the big tent designed by Richard Rogers and have an exhibition to mark the millennium. A lot of money was spent on reclaiming the ground, and the ambition was that ultimately it would trigger the development of new homes, more commercial space. But the legacy for the tent itself hadn't been properly established. During the millennium, I, along with probably 10 million other people, visited the exhibition. And rather ironically, in the center of the tent was a temporary arena that hosted probably 8 shows a day all the way through the year. A Cirque du Soleil show with temporary lighting, temporary speakers, temporary seating. After the exhibition, no one really knew what to do with the tent. The tent remained, and you'll see here all of the rubble of the demolished pavilions. And it became a bit of a national embarrassment. The government was paying for the upkeep of the tent, but had no idea what to do with it. Until AEG, an American arena group, came along and offered to invest and build a new 20,000-seat arena. And the idea was that the tent was still there, the arena would be built in the center, and around it, they were going to create an entertainment district that had bars, restaurants, cinemas, lots of other activities. And that's what subsequently has turned out to give you the statistic of Geraint, that 3 million people come to watch a concert or a show in the actual arena, but 6 million people actually visit just to go to the entertainment district and the food and the drink. Technically, it was a very difficult project to build because we had the tent already in situ. So the whole arena had to be built from the ground up. So you see the vertical cores here. You see the roof that's being jacked up into position. And we often talk about it like the ship in the bottle, where suddenly a major venue has to pop up within the tent. But this was the end result. An arena that redefined for the UK what arenas could be. Much greater levels of comfort, technology, the bars and restaurants and the facilities were unlike anything that an arena at that stage had had. It was important to make the connection to the transport infrastructure. So during the Millennium Festival, the underground had been connected to North Greenwich, and so this was a canopy that runs all the way from the bus and tube station, taking you right to the front door of the arena. The naming rights deal with O2, was also quite significant, first sort of major naming rights deal in the UK, so we were looking at how we integrated that within the venue as well. And it became a new London landmark, so it actually turned around what had been seen as a failed project. A lot of criticism of the government for having spent all the money on the reclamation and the construction of the tent, and now arguably is one of the most significant landmarks on the London skyline. And in terms of O2, I think probably one of the most successful naming rights partnerships. In terms of the arena itself, it's a very flexible space. It's arranged around the ice hockey and basketball floor, but it has retractable seating that give you ultimate flexibility in the format. You have a double rigging structure in the roof that allows, again, that flexibility for arena operators to have a show on one evening and have the next show ready to go afterwards. So it's a very fast turnover of shows and events. These are some of the examples of the types of show. This is the ATP tennis finals. I think one of the best efforts that the O2 does in terms of the lighting, presentation of a sport that perhaps you wouldn't have considered being a very attractive sport within an arena setting. It adapts itself to events like motorsport, so again, very flexible in the way that the floor can be adapted. But concerts have been the big driver, and there's been a big shift in the last 10 or 12 years from the use in an arena from more sports-based content to very much a concert-led type of a venue. This was Adele back on the opening night of her tour, and the O2 has hosted many, many famous acts over the years. In terms of the interiors, there's a range of spaces. We have sort of concessions, bars and food for main spectators. The boxes are quite innovative, very wide. They're open into the arena, so quite attractive spaces to be. And then we had the O2 sponsor lounges. So part of the commercial part of the project was in developing those facilities. Naming rights was our first sort of major activation project. So O2, which is a mobile phone operator, we came up with the idea of the glowing blue light, and that glowing blue light runs through all the signage, runs through the interior spaces, and ultimately into some of the O2 sponsor spaces as well. Now, 10 years on, it's interesting, the venue is now starting to go through an upgrade. So we went back to the venue, we looked at the food and drink concessions, and we've given those a good refresh because the O2 is now competing with other venues within London and elsewhere. And it's been interesting to see over time, as the success of the arena has developed, the regeneration is now starting to take shape. The cable car was installed across the river, the underground and the bus station is here, and we're starting to see the signs of that wider regeneration. So the second case study is the London Stadium, or the Olympic Stadium as was. And this has quite an interesting story. I worked on the first phase of the project, so designing the stadium for the Games. And again, there's a common thread here. The sort of site we were given was this island site out in Stratford in East London, a very poor part of the city, a lot of industrial units and wasteland. And this was where the government decided to invest money into the regeneration linked to the creation of the Olympic Park. Sustainability was a big agenda for London 2012. And we were challenged to consider a building that could be 80,000 seats for the Games and reduced to 25,000 seats afterwards. And we came up with this sort of phrase of embracing the temporary. So we looked at how we could minimize the footprint of the stadium, use the least possible material, have the least weight, and broke the building down into a series of components. So we had the seating bowl, 25,000 permanent seats, the upper tier, the 55,000 temporary seats, a roof that sat over the top of it, and a wrap that went around the stadium. We developed this idea of the stadium island. So the River Lee wraps around on two sides of the site, and you actually enter the stadium on the bridges. So the turnstile and ticket check was here, and once you were on the island, you were effectively within the stadium. The food and drink concessions were mainly outside because the Olympic Games is a summer event. The weather is always good in the UK in the summer, so it was very easy to have lots of outdoor spaces. And this was the stadium in Games mode. A lot of new landscaping, investment in trees, the spectator facilities on the outside, and as I promised you, a glorious sunny day. The wrap was a sort of a concept of wrapping around what was a very basic structure. And we had fun working with an artist, Sophie Smallhorn, to create this sort of colour concept running around the inside of the wrap, trying to take some of the branding from the Games and introduce that into the design of the venue. It had opportunities for lighting and illumination during the Games, which again helped give the stadium a real presence. In terms of facilities, there were some core facilities that we had to provide. We needed, obviously, changing facilities and the warm-up track. The IOC requires a certain amount of accommodation for its guests, for the Olympic family. But we literally limited that to a pavilion in the West Stand. We used the roof as a roof terrace for spectators to use as a concourse. And it was a very lightweight approach to providing the facilities within the stadium. The roof was designed with Bureau Happold, a very simple but efficient compression ring that allowed a fabric roof to extend with sports lighting on the front. But that roof had to also accommodate all of the theatrical lighting, all of the requirements of the ceremonies. So we had to design in several years before the games, long before Danny Boyle had designed his ceremony, all of the sort of wires and cables and firework positions that would run around the roof of the stadium and be utilized as part of that ceremony. And then the seating bowl, 25,000 seats in a temporary in the lower tier permanent, and 55,000 temporary seats in the upper tier. That created a really amazing cauldron for the Olympics. And if any of you were there for the games, the atmosphere around the athletics was quite electric. It was very, it echoed a lot, the Colosseum, which Geraint showed you earlier, and it proved itself to be an amazing place to host athletics. And it was interesting to do a comparison of the sections. So this in black was the London Stadium, and in red we had the Beijing Bird's Nest Stadium. And the key components of London was to reduce the amount of material we put in the stadium, reuse where possible, so a lot of the steelwork and pipes came from a recycled steel. And we looked to recycle about 42% of the materials used in construction were recycled. So the opening ceremony, the stadium transforms into this amazing theatre for Danny Boyle, who created a wonderful show to open the Olympics. Within a week, it had to transform back into a sports facility, hosting Mo Farah and many other amazing athletes during the games. And then after the games, we came to the transformation. And a lot of the transformation had been planned beforehand. So you'll see here at the Aquatic Centre, the partial removal of the temporary seating that was always planned to come away from the Aquatic Centre. This is the water polo arena that was designed to be temporary and is now the development site for the new cultural quarter. The basketball arena has already been removed because we didn't need two new arenas in the park and we were already building the copper box here. But the story around the stadium is more complex. When it was designed in 2005, the political requirements were for an athletics legacy and no Premier League football. It was felt not to be good to put government money into private football. In 2012, we'd had the economic crisis. We'd had a change of mayor. The new mayor said the stadium needs to be viable, and the only way to make a stadium like this viable is to have a professional football team in it. So West Ham United went through a competitive process, and so the brief for the stadium changed, and actually instead of reducing to a 25,000-seat athletic stadium, it now needed to be a 70 or 80,000 multi-purpose stadium that could host football, athletics, concerts, and any other events you could imagine. So we had to rethink what we were doing. And what we did was keep the sort of athletics track, but introduce retractable seating that would allow you to have a typical athletics event for 54,000 people. And then the seating would come in for the rectangular sport, so the movable seating in the lower tier. And again, for concerts, making sure that the stadium was developed to accommodate concerts within it. So just a quick 3D image showing you. This is the stadium in its athletics mode. All of the retractable seating are in its outward position so that you can get the track in. And then they shuffle forward and get you a much better proximity to the football pitch. In terms of the roof, once those seats move in, it meant that we had to extend the area of roof so that you had roof cover over the seats. So this was the roof as it was in the original Olympic Games mode. We managed to reuse and strengthen the steel structure on the outside and then designed a new roof that would extend in to give you a point of coverage that would cover the seating when it was around the rectangular field. These are the sections that just show you how that works. So this is with the extended roof, a huge sort of cantilevered structure, utilizing the original structure from the games. This is the seating, the temporary seating in athletics mode. And here, when it moves forward, it comes closer to the football pitch and you make sure that you get the front line of the roof matching the front line of the seating tier. And the stadium has been very successful. Within a couple of years, the 2015 Rugby World Cup took place within the stadium. I would hasten to add it wasn't quite finished, but we did manage to get the stadium open to host the event. The following year, West Ham United moved in, and they are now the regular tenant, This is the football format, and they're just about to change the green surround to a purple surround to make it look and feel more like a West Ham stadium. Concerts have been a very attractive venue for concerts, particularly summer concerts. And then back to athletics for the 2017 IAAF World Championships. And I went to the event here, and it was great to see the stadium back as it was for the Olympics, hosting again major sport and athletics within the stadium. And coming up this summer, another innovative event, Major League Baseball. The first time that Major League Baseball is bringing an event over to the UK, and we've managed to design the seating bowl to accommodate the baseball diamond actually within it. And I tried to get tickets for the event back earlier in the year, completely sold out. So it'll be interesting to see how that runs this year. So a last slide on London. We did have our IAKS event there about a month ago, and it was fascinating to see how, with the legacy stadium in place, the aquatic centre and the landscape, but also all of the wider development that is happening. There are universities that are relocating or building in the park, so there's going to be 10,000 students there. The Athletes' Village, which is just off to the side here, has provided a lot of new residents for the park, and there are four new schools that have already been built around the outskirts. So a very successful legacy story. Finally, the Tottenham Stadium. This has been the project that has occupied me for the last 7 years, so it's been quite a project. And this is an image from the Champions League match against Manchester City. You may just make out the phrase, "To dare is to do," which is the club's motto, and is a motto that has been very true for this project. Every day, we've been daring and doing, and it's amazing to see the stadium open. The concept of the stadium was as part of a wider master plan. This whole area of London was affected badly by the riots in 2011, and the stadium is a £1 billion private investment by the club right in the centre of this new wider master plan, which the local authority aimed to link Northumberland Park Station to White Hart Lane. The stadium itself has a number of parts to it. It had a supermarket, commercial and office piece that was built first, the stadium that has just been completed, the Tottenham Experience, which is the museum and shop, a new hotel and residential part to it. And this is how the project is now. So you'll see this is Lillywhite House, which is the first phase of development. The stadium now sitting right on the high road. It's a very unique site to be right on the high road, and that gave us quite a lot of design challenges in how we made that work. And we had the interesting challenge of making a new building fit with historic structure. So the Georgian Terrace that sits here at the north is part of a conservation area. We tried to create the Tottenham Experience to echo that height with the West Stand entrance, but then a very modern stadium that rises behind it. The stadium itself has a seating bowl that's quite unique. We have the big single-tier stand, 17,500 seats, which is a sort of throwback to traditional football. We have the hospitality just on the east and the west. And what that gives us is a very asymmetrical seating bowl, something that we felt modern stadia were perhaps becoming a little bit sterile, looking all very much the same. And so this was an attempt to create some of that unique quality that football stadia have evolved over the years. So at the south end, this is the single-tier stand. It's intended to be where the home fans sort of gather and generate the atmosphere for the stadium. Around that, the seating bowl creates this sort of U-shape that completes it. And we have 62,000 seats. And what's also interesting is the way that the hospitality, which is in yellow, just runs on the two edges where the most value is, running along the side of the pitch. And also we have other hospitality spaces that run along the centre line, which again is where the value is in the seating. Always interesting, I don't know if you can quite make out the comparison in scale. So this is the old White Hart Lane Stadium. This is the new Tottenham Stadium, and here we have Wembley, and you can see just how far away the fans can be at the back of Wembley and how we tried to design the new stadium to get them closer to the pitch. But this section, I think, gives a clue as to some of the reasons and some of the influences that have come through from American stadia with lots of different levels and facilities. So a tunnel club, three levels of hospitality, an atrium that connects all of these spaces, and a sky lounge included at the top of the building where typically you wouldn't ever have hospitality space. The south stand, the single tier, has a giant bridging structure that allows the natural grass pitch to slide underneath. And the club wanted to be able to accommodate American football and to be able to accommodate it on an artificial pitch. And I'll show you some slides later as to explain how the artificial pitch sits underneath the grass pitch. Technology is a major part of the stadium. So we have very large giant screens in the corners. We have LED ribbon boards that wrap all the way around the stadium. We have full Wi-Fi and mobile coverage. So again, technology has been a large part of the brief of the project. And the other thing is really to create experiences for all of the different spectators. So we have a marketplace with different food concepts for the general spectators. We have a premium GA areas where spectators can upgrade to a slightly better product. We have a microbrewery that is built into the stadium. We have a range of corporate facilities, restaurants, lounges, networking lounges that runs all the way up, including the Sky Lounge. And then we have kind of unique spaces, so these premium hospitality spaces. And I think that's one of the differences of this stadium, lots of different opportunities for people on their match day. This is an image of the South Stand atrium, a five-story space that the fans come in. They drop down half a level to the marketplace, a 70-meter-long bar, or they come up into their concourse. And this is how that space looks in reality. The two giant trees support the tier because that's where the sliding pitch is moving underneath. This is the marketplace. So the idea of this big 70-meter-long bar, the length, the width of the football pitch, different food options. And this is an image of that on the test event, full of people. We created terraces that people could stand and sit, watch the screen. They have concerts put there after the match. And we're finding that people are staying here an hour, 2 hours after the event. They're coming 2 hours early. The stadium's running out of beer because they're selling so much more than they expected. We have a microbrewery. Craft beer is a big industry in the UK. There's a lot of attraction for craft beer. So we worked with a local brewer called Beavertown to create an active brewery where they will brew the beer for the stadium and a tap room to drink. And this is an image of that in reality. You'll see the stainless steel tanks there for the actual brewery. And these are the facilities that can be open on a non-match day so that the stadium can be used outside of football. This is the sort of upgrade space, the GA Plus space that has a view into the stadium and a slightly better quality of space. And then the sort of feature areas. So the tunnel club, which has the glass wall that allows people to watch the players as they come in and out of the pitch. The H Club, which is the sort of top end restaurant set in the middle of the West Stand. And then my favorite space, which is the Sky Lounge at the top. And this space has the view out over the city on one side and a view down into the seating bowl. So we're trying to create lots of different types of spaces within the venue. The ability to transform was another big component. So we had the natural grass pitch for football and the desire to transform to NFL for the club to be able to host American football. The challenges with that are the pitch is usually destroyed by American footballers if they play on natural grass. So the club wanted an artificial pitch underneath for that. And often, because the American football players line up on the side, you have to screen off maybe 15 rows of spectators. But by using a moving pitch, we were able to slide the grass pitch out underneath the south stand to create an NFL surface underneath. And that change in level means that the front row of seats for football could be the same as the front row of seats for NFL. This is a video now that will just explain how that works. So the pitch actually has to split into three so that we can get lines of columns to support under the south stand. So you get the end piece moves out on one side, then the centerpiece rolls out on rails, and then the final piece moves out, revealing underneath the artificial surface that will be used for NFL. Now that looks very simple. That's 10,000 tons of grass pitch that has to be moved out on rails, and it's a very sophisticated piece of engineering, and a company called SCX done a fantastic job on that technology. In section, you'll see here, this is the actual tray within which the grass, the natural grass, sits, and it's basically going to come underneath the south stand. So it slides out and reveals the artificial pitch underneath. The technical challenge we had was, how does the grass come back together? So it's never been done before that we have a joint in a football field where it comes back together. And the concern, obviously, was would studs get caught in that joint? So over a period of 2 years with the club, we built smaller prototypes and then a full-scale prototype at the training ground to check that the technology for bringing the grass back together would work and that it wouldn't actually cause any trip hazards. And after 6 months of testing at the training ground, the club was confident that it would work. A last couple of last few slides just to show you the outdoor space. So as well as the stadium, there's a big public square because this is where the pitch slides out and sits underneath the podiums, underneath the public square. We have the Tottenham Experience, which is the shop and museum, a hotel, which is used to drive conference and banqueting in the stadium, and we have the commercial and residential blocks on the side. That space is equivalent to the outdoor space at Trafalgar Square. So it's a very significant public space that's been created by the project, and one that we think will be activated strongly by the club, opportunities to have informal football and other events here, landscaping that creates a very attractive public realm. But also on a match day, it has to operate and function with all of the safety and security that we were talking about beforehand. This is an extreme sports building, so again, the club has been concerned to have other facilities that will attract people to the site. And that's a shot now from that corner. You'll see here the Tottenham Experience. We had to retain and integrate a listed Georgian townhouse, so we kind of designed this sort of modern building that reflects the height of the Georgian building. We tried to echo the rhythm of the glass. This is a cast iron cladding that tries to give you a sort of contemporary architecture in that block. And then this glass box at the front with this halo video screen, which is the sort of entrance to the site. The last little bit of a treat is the skywalk. So if you see the gap in the cladding here, that's actually an outdoor walk where you clip on the inside, you walk up onto the roof. That's a bungee drop position, so you can bungee down to the ground. Or you can walk along this glass platform across the glass roof and be directly above the pitch. So lots of crazy ideas that we were encouraged to introduce by our client. I haven't been brave enough to try the skywalk yet, but maybe next time I'll see you, I'll have been able to get the courage. So a very ambitious project with Tottenham. We've been challenged to redefine the stadium experience, but it's a project which we hope has moved people's perception of what these buildings can be forward. Thank you very much.